good morning. Welcome to church this morning. We are going to ask you to stand to your feet this morning. And we are going to worship God. And maybe you got the newsletter yesterday. I can't even see very well through this screen. But now that we have these screens built, thank you, Randy, for all the hard work and effort going into building these screens. What we are asking is that you join us in worship. Yet in the newsletter yesterday, and maybe if you didn't get the newsletter, but we're asking you don't join us in singing loudly. However, my heart's just been stirring this week as we've been preparing. I've been reading a lot through the book of Joshua and looking at the Israelites going and the worshipers leading the way into battle and leading into victory. And what we're asking is that in no way do you not worship. We still encourage you, worship in all that you have within you, in spirit and in truth. Raise your hands, kneel before the Lord, allow the songs to minister to us as we just exalt God on high. You can even quietly speak the words or get out a journal and write what God is saying to you. We're just asking for the safety and for our health unit and the regulations that we're under is that we're asking that you do not sing out loud. And so if we can honor that and respect that, but we still want to just worship God today, and we're so glad that we can lift our voices in song here and hopefully just build us up in spirit as we worship God together. So welcome again this morning, and just join with us. Clap along and tap your foot. Do whatever you want to do. Posture yourself in worship to worship along.
Worship our King, and come let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. We'll see what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Lord Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Well, you've been faithful through every storm, amen. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. Well, God, you do great things. Oh hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive. You break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Let's lift our hands, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Well, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah. Well, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Oh hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. God, you do great things.
Amen. This next song is going to be a new one to you. We pray that the words just minister to you and as we worship along together. Let me just get organized here again. Just lift our hands and our hearts in this place. Hallelujah. Our God reigns. Hallelujah.
Let's sing hallelujah. 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 Our God reigns. Hallelujah.
God, you are worthy of all our praise. You're worthy, Lord God. Our God reigns. No matter what's happening around us, you reign on high. I'm just going to ask Carol to come forward, and we're going to hear from the Word of God through Scripture this morning.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Has the Lord redeemed you? Then speak out. Tell others he has redeemed you from your enemies. Praise the Lord for his great love and the wonderful things he has done. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Great is his love, higher than the heavens. His faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Everything the Lord does reveals his glory and majesty. His righteousness never fails. He causes us to remember his wonderful works. How gracious and merciful is our Lord. He gives food to those who fear him. He always remembers his covenant. All he does is just and good, and all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully with integrity. He has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, lift up holy hands in prayer and praise the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever.
Amen.
Amen. Let's just continue to worship together with one more song. There is no one like him. And as that psalm just said, may we lift up holy hands. May our hearts just connect with God. The bridge of this song talks about how we will build our life upon him, the firm foundation, the solid rock. I don't know about you, but there are times where in an unsteady world and when things seem to change everywhere, so much hope is found in that foundation that never moves. Hebrews says that he is the anchor for our soul. And I just love knowing that I can run to him, our strong tower. Allow us to just sing. Just lift your hearts together.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, and worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. He's Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Allow the truth of this bridge to just minister to you today. I will build my life. Upon your love, it is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love.
There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's just make this bridge our prayer.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will not be shaken.
Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you so much how we can be here to this morning, and how we could wake up this morning, and how you just led us, each of us, to be here right now. It's all by your grace and just so much love from you to each of us, oh God. Thank you so much, God, that how we can just bow down before you through the Jesus, cover all of us with your precious blood and fill us with your Holy Spirit in this place right now. Jesus is speaking today. Are you burdened? Are you worried? Come to us. Come to me. Just come to me, I will give you rest. Are you thirsty? Are you looking for something to fill your soul, your heart? Come to me, come to me. Drink from me, I am the living water. Oh Father, please speak to us and touch our hearts today. And as we come together, oh Father, pray for the unity from you in our church. Now may the God who gives endurance and encouragement grant you harmony with one another in Christ Jesus, so that with one mind and one voice you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 15:5-6. Father, let us overcome this message of the isolation from the world. Let us overcome these physical barriers, that let it not to be barriers in our church. Let us just stay connected, our hearts to be stay connected through Holy Spirit in you. And as a body of Christ, you may just continue strengthen our church. Continue be the Lord and master of our church. And each body part remains healthy and strong as well. And we can move forward to do your will. And we also leave all the churches around the world as well as we continue to serve. We just need direction from you. Speak clear to each churches to come in unity and to seek you and to seek your kingdom through this, all the setbacks. Nothing will hold us back. as you are with us and we are on your side. Oh, thank you, Father. And we live up annual business meeting coming up in our church with all the board members. Father, you may help them to prepare well, that you will give them insight to see the right direction, how Glad Tidings can be moving forward this year, coming year, and just give them all ideas, inspire them, guide them, and then help them to come together in harmony to make decisions. Oh, Father, we want to just remember and lift up our church families who are all facing health issues. Especially we think of Kathy, Roland, and Diana, Britton, and Bonnie Holdsworth. We believe that you are in them, and just the power of healing is in you. We believe in you, and you are the healer. And just pray over them, the miracle of your hands, the hands of the healing will open their body, all the body parts, and inside and out. Oh, Father, strengthen them and pour your peace from you as they're going through these health challenges. They will continue to look on you. Also pray for mental and emotional health. It might not be always visible, but it is so painful. Father, among many voices they are hearing from themselves or from enemies or from the society, but help them to tune in your voice. Help us to discern your voice. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Father, we look to you. Renew our minds every day in the Lord. Father, as Pastor is going to share us message today, that it will speak right into our hearts. Let us prepare our hearts to just listen, directly hear from you, and obey to your voice. Thank you, Jesus. Pray it in your precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God is so faithful. Just before Pastor Lewis comes and speaks, I wanted to just share a few announcements with you to bring you up to speed with a few things that are happening. First and foremost, next Sunday is our AGM, annual general meeting, and so we want to make sure that you know of that. It's going to be right after the service. We're going to be doing it here live, and we're also going to be streaming it as well for those who can't come in person. Later today, we're going to be emailing out the business report to you in your email if you're part of our mailing list. If you would like a copy of it and you don't get one, then email us at info@gtpcperth.com and we'll make sure that we get one to you. Or if you'd rather have a physical copy, then please speak to us too and we'll try to arrange that as well. But so next Sunday, right after the service, be in prayer for that and just be encouraged that as we look forward to the new year, everything that God has in store for us, and as we continue to look for him for guidance. Small groups have been going really well. We wanted to just encourage you again, if you haven't considered that, or if you haven't been part of a small group, please prayerfully consider that. We're not trying to twist your arm or force you into it, but it really is something that we're finding beneficial. We're going through a small group study, Abide, and it's really just getting us back down to the basics of spending time with God and daily devotions and abiding in him. And so I know myself, personally, I've been encouraged by it and encouraged by my small group, just pouring into each other's lives. And just iron sharpens iron, and we've been just growing together. As well, one last thing is if you would like any daily breads that have been coming into the office and you would like a copy of that for your personal devotion, then please email us again at info@gtpcperth.com. Or if you don't have email and you would like a copy of it, then just speak to us, one of us pastors, and we'll make sure that we can get that to you in your hands. I think that's all the morning announcements. I'll ask Pastor Lewis to come and share the word of God today.
Thank you, worship team. Thank you, worship team. How's that? Better? Still a little loud up here, Andrew. Oh, wow. 1996, the Atlanta Olympic Games. Do you remember those? Yeah, they were relatively close to us. The U.S. women's softball team faced off against Australia in one of the games, and in the fifth inning at a 0-0 tie, and softball games only go to seven innings, but in the fifth inning, 20-year-old American Danielle Tyler hit a home run over the center field fence. And Tyler is a pretty composed and very structured person, not one to give in lots of celebration, but she said that she floated around the bases, it seemed, and the adrenaline rush in her was just amazing, and when she coming rounding third, going to home, and she was greeted by a swarm of well-wishing teammates, and in all the excitement, she lost her focus, and she didn't touch home plate. The Americans lost that game. So today we're going to look at another way that we can persevere, and that is by not getting distracted. Don't sidestep things so that you miss home plate. Don't even get distracted that I haven't opened my message like I usually do, telling you about all the things we've studied so far, and, you know, where's he going? Wow, did I miss something? Don't even get distracted that. Get rid of or throw off anything that distracts you if you want to persevere. So if this keeps cracking, should I go to another mic? Yeah? Okay, I'm going to go to this one. All right, how's that? No more cracking. Let's trust the Lord for that. Turn, if you have your Bibles with you and you want to turn with us, we're going to look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. We've looked at this verse before. Last week we looked at the second half of the verse. This time we're going to look at the first part of the verse. If we want to persevere, this is really important for us. Therefore, since you are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race that is marked off for us. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Those two things we need to persevere. So let's look at hindrances first. Now, let me preface my message much as I have in past messages about perseverance. I know that we have all been stressed. Okay, who has not been stressed in the last 12 months? Raise your hand. If you have not been stressed, Paul, you're amazing. Someone check his temperature later. Mental health issues are real, and I'm not trying to belittle that at all as I talk about perseverance. But are we allowing that stress to keep us from persevering is a really important question for us. Not only am I not minimizing mental health and emotional strength, but I know that there is God in our lives. See, what we are living through is very, very real. I was talking to my neighbor across the street 2 weeks ago, and just in that previous week, the very first person in her life, family, extended family, passed away from COVID. After 11 months in Canada, the first person, I have had about 9 or 10 in my family and extended family friends. And I'm sure many of you know people who have been affected. This is real. But you know what? So is God. Isn't he? He is real. He is very real. He's the one actually who formed our emotions and our mental capacity. He formed us in our mother's wombs. He knit us together. He made these physical bodies. He knows even the limits of these physical bodies and our emotional limits. He understands even our spiritual limits because he sent his son to die for our soul. See, and because he knows that, he understands and knows that we were created to persevere. As we learned last week, we can ask, what would Jesus do? We could listen and look at his teachings, model our life after him, and he gives us the power to persevere, to do what Jesus would do. And this whole series that I've been teaching on it is about that. And to persevere, we need to think differently about time, the time we have on earth and the time that's short before his second coming. We need to consider that our brothers and sisters around the world are being persecuted. That will help us persevere. We need to fix our eyes on Jesus, even as Hebrews 12:1 said at the beginning of that. We need to pray and ask others to pray for us. We need to remain in community with like-minded people. All of those things and many more will help us persevere. And I am aware, as I'm sure you are as well, of many things that keep us from persevering. One, because I'm human, like you. But secondly, because of my role as a pastor. And I've come to discover one of those top, you know, maybe it's in the top three or four things that is a significant hindrance to people is this: holding on to the past. Our past is a huge hindrance to perseverance. Have you ever talked to a person who's always saying, oh, do it this way, this is the way it worked for me, or we used to do it this way, do it this way because that's the right way? And I'm not talking about, you know, perhaps grandparents complaining about their grandkids. You know, I'm not talking that. I'm talking about everyone. Many people use this type of language. Like, consider this. See if you don't look at the past. 12 months ago, we weren't wearing masks. At least not in our corner of the world. There's places around the globe that have been wearing masks for years, but we weren't 12 months ago. 13 months ago, on the horizon, just a little bit of our mind was occupied with this thing called COVID-19. 14 months ago, we were celebrating Christmas, and we had no clue that it might be the last time in a long time that we were going to have turkey and family and friends all in the same place. But you hear it in almost every conversation you have. People who talk like they are locked into the past 12 months, 13 months, 14 months ago. And they fail to see the opportunities that God has and that he sees as his world changes day after day after day. There is the hindrance, living in how things used to be. Complaining about the loss of our civil freedoms. What if we have to wear masks for more years than just 2020 and 2021? I know, 12 months ago we weren't wearing them. We didn't even really consider masks unless it was, you know, Halloween or something. Very few of us went into intensive care units and had to put on masks, other than some of our medical people that work in that situation. But there are people that you and I talk with and live with each and every day that still haven't accepted this as reality. This is present day. It's not 12 months ago. Living in the past keeps us from seeing with our spiritual eyes what God is doing and what he can do and what he wants to do in his world through you. Now, here's something really important that I've learned about Scripture. See, God does not live in the past. Now, listen to what I say. Nowhere in his word does he say, hey, listen, I parted the Red Sea for Moses, so I'm going to part the Red Sea for you. What he says is this: I parted the Red Sea for Moses. What makes you think I can't see you through? Are you blind to the lessons of the past? What he does in the Old Testament, and it's full of references to the past, not glorifying the past, but learning from the past, letting our hearts be encouraged and strengthened to persevere because of what God did in the past, knowing that today he can do the same kind of thing, not the same thing. Don't look for the Red Sea to part. God did that. But look for what he can do in your situations to change your life, to help you get through COVID-19, if that's the biggest thing on your horizon, or perhaps that doctor report that you got, or perhaps the financial situation that you find yourself in. Whatever the Red Sea is in your life, know that God did that before, and he will do something spectacular if you look to him and live with an understanding that he will help you persevere. Now, this is key. I've been learning this for a few years. I've been studying this just about how I can try to make an impact on the life that I have lived, how I can pass that on, how I could do something. And I've learned that the key to mentoring younger generations is not living in the past, but taking my past and applying it to the present. So he might have separated the Red Sea for me so I could walk through on dry ground. But if there's no Red Sea, but it doesn't make sense for me to encourage people, oh, just trust that the Red Sea is going to be parted. No, see, what God is going to do is far greater than that, far more spectacular than that, because you're living in it right now. Have you ever talked with Rita Dixon over there? She's a senior, I say that very respectfully, who I enjoy talking to and listening to her stories, and how many know she has great stories? Rita, bear with me here. You know what I love about it? She talks about how God miraculously healed her, intervened in her life, did spectacular things, and typically, I've heard this from her, I'm sure it's every time, and I've heard her say, God did this for me. I can't wait, and I will pray for, and I want to see what he's going to do for you. She doesn't just take her stories and transplant them into my life. Rita, you don't live in the past, it seems. We can't let the past be a hindrance for what God wants to do today. Let it be an inspiration. Know that God parted the Red Sea. Know that God saved Rita from a car accident. Know that God has healed my heart and made it completely new after I had a heart attack. Know that he has done amazing things. Think of what he can do next. Live forward. Live in the present and forward so that we can see and understand that we can make it through this because we made it through that. 4 weeks ago, you might remember when I opened up this part of the series, we had talked about why we must persevere for many weeks, and then 4 weeks ago, we started how we persevere, and I said it's going to take thinking differently. Right? We have to have a change in thought process because we are kingdom citizens and we need to think differently to persevere. We have to throw off those things that hinder us. Besides living in the past, there's another thing that hinders us, and this is a condition of our culture, and we all have some form of it, but it's over busyness. No one's been there, right? And it's not wrong to be busy. Actually, I marvel at many people who are just like, you know, they don't seem to have blood in their veins. It's all adrenaline, you know. They're going all the time. And I get exhausted thinking about it sometimes. And you know, someone once said to me, oh, Lewis, it shows you're getting older. Okay, but I refuse that. I just marvel at the way some people can go, and they really get a lot done. See, God designed us to work. He also designed us to rest. And he also designed us to commune with him. And as humans, when any of those three get out of balance, we tend to bolt towards one of the others. We're like pendulums, but only there's three, you know, kind of axis on this pendulum. And it's either over-busyness or under-busyness or, you know, running from God. And we don't really just... We don't really live well in balance. For instance, as COVID has locked us down, and in the last little while, we went from in December till 2 weeks ago or last week, we went into this stay home thing, you know. That bred inactivity. And we were doing everything we can just to keep exercising or to walk around the house or, you know, like you have to do that. But it was just natural when we're so cooped up as human beings. This is what humans go through. We then need to go to the other extreme and get super busy again. Or we got to find things to do. We need people to connect with. We need activities. That's normal because that's human. Very few people, however, run to the balance or to the side of the communing with God more when we are stressed from overactivity or underactivity. There are people who learn to carve out time for God to get things back into balance. And there's some people that I marvel at who do that very naturally. I personally have to work hard at it, as most people that I know do. But it's far easier to move from being over busy to just sleeping it off or to vegging out. And it's far easier to just kind of be fed up of lying on the couch and get up and just, you know, like cut your lawn and your neighbor's lawn or shovel snow your driveway, your neighbor's driveway. We just tend to fill our lives up with busyness. But if we observe those people who have persevered well in Scripture, in our life, we learn that they make time for God. That's what helps them persevere. Jesus modeled this for us. Crowds of people constantly came to him, and if I was living then, I probably would have gone to him as well, because he taught great things and he healed people. And Luke 5:15 tells us this: the news about him spread all the more, so the crowds of people came to him to hear him and to be healed of their sickness. But Jesus often withdrew to a lonely place to pray. Communed with God. His busyness was too much. He needed his God time. The inactivity of lockdown that we have faced, or stay-home orders, and the truth is we might face them again. As I stated, these are real stresses in 2021. This is real. And you can't just think them away. You can't put on virtual reality glasses and play on a beach in Aruba. You're not there. When you take them off, you're confronted with the same reality. And your enemy, the enemy of your soul, wants to take you down a path that leads to destruction breaking of your faith, chopping it up and throwing it out the window. Much like we learned about Job's wife who encouraged him to just forsake God and die. That's what our enemy wants us to do. But persevering means throwing off everything that hinders us from completing that race. Listen, throw off inactivity and replace it with spending time with God. Throw off overactivity and replace it with spending time with God. When you throw off what hinders you from keeping God in that first place on your schedule, you will persevere. Okay, next, not only do we need to throw off hindrances, but we need to throw off the sin that so easily entangles. Moses is a good example for us because it brings a lot of balance to this thought. He did just that. He threw off the sin that would entangle him so that he could pursue God's purposes in his life. Get this, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25, the writer speaks of Moses. And he says, Moses chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. Well, what was that? See, he grew up in Pharaoh's palace as a son of Pharaoh's daughter, and he had all the luxuries, all the benefits of royalty, like one of our, you know, Prince Andrews or something. They can get a helicopter and fly from point A to B just if they want, because those are all the luxuries of stuff that they are allowed. Just as Moses rejected all of that and threw that off so that he would not be entangled by sin, so must we. And see, this is the part where, like, some of the things aren't really sinful things. And we'll talk about what are in just a moment. But consider this. Joseph was hired by Pharaoh years after Moses, and he had all the privilege, it seems, that Moses would have had by being a son of Pharaoh's daughter. And Joseph used all that wealth and power to pursue what God wanted for his people. But Moses, years earlier, understood that that would have enticed him to sin. So wealth, pedigree, those aren't wrong in and of themselves, but in Moses' life, obviously, it would have been a stumbling block, and he had to throw that off. Paul warned Timothy in the New Testament. Here's this young minister that Paul was mentoring and trying to encourage as he was pastoring one of the churches that Paul had worked through, and Paul set him up to pastor, and in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, Paul gives him this warning. He says, no one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affairs, but rather tries to please his commanding officer. And as I just mentioned, not necessarily everything is a sin, but there are things that can become sinful by letting them take the first place away from God in our lives. See, civilian affairs aren't bad, but the soldier learns to distinguish between civilian affairs and military affairs, that which his commanding officer has asked him to do. The civilian affairs aren't evil, they're not bad, and there is a time for them, but the basis for that soldier being dismissed could be that he spent military time pursuing civilian affairs. He needs to concentrate, think about the work that he is doing, and we are all thankful as our military does that work for us, aren't we? So likewise, some things aren't sinful in and of themselves, Many things become sinful when they entangle us and they draw us into sin. They take God out of first place in our life. They just move him down and they put these other things into first place in our life. And Hebrews 1 is saying, throw those sins off. Just throw those entanglements off, because they're just going to bind you up and distract you from what God wants for you. 1 Peter 5:8. Be alert and sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Only you know the sin in your life that you need to deal with, those things that have entangled you. Maybe it's your health. Like, that's not a bad thing at all, right? But maybe it's really easy to find time to exercise and to eat well, but to read God's word and to meditate, well, you don't have time for that, because maybe even your family can entangle you and draw you to sin. You know, you have time to talk on the phone or be with your family, spend time with people who you love, but when it comes time to talking to God, it's thank you very much for the day, amen. Materialism, the things we acquire. And some people have to work so much harder and longer just to keep up with what they have, rather than reevaluating life for more simplicity and more God-directed needs. What is he providing for you? Or anxieties. And maybe you have all the time in the world to complain and to talk about the negative stuff that we live in, because we live in it. It's real. This COVID-19 is real. I'm not belittling it. But if all of our conversations are caught up in what, the governments are doing now, or what they're going to do tomorrow and they're going to lock us out, and rather than spending time and letting the Holy Spirit, like we learned last week, bring hope to our spirits, then perhaps our anxieties become an entanglement and draw us into sin. Now, of course, there are actual sinful things that entangle us. Things like unforgiveness. Oh, I don't even have to talk about that, do I? We all know what it's like to be entangled by the bitterness of unforgiveness. Things like telling lies. Big lies, white lies, they entangle us. How many of you know one lie needs to another lie? When I tell Lydia, this was before COVID. Well, I went to Tim Hortons, I had a tea. And she says, is that all? I said, well, yeah, I had sugar in my tea. I didn't tell her about the donut, I'm kidding. I'm using this as an example. No, this isn't real. See how white lies can entangle us? We just have to get further and further into the lie to cover up. It's an entanglement. It keeps us from persevering. Or hatred that we might have in our soul towards a race or a colored skin tone person, or someone who's not as wealthy as us or doesn't have our education, or, these things creep in and they destroy us. They entangle us. Or the sin of adultery, having sex outside of marriage. There are some things that are obvious sins, and those entangle us just like those other sins that creep up on us and replace God in our life. Let me conclude with this. Remember the story I opened with, 1996 Olympics? Let me give you some more details about that story. The women's U.S. softball team won the gold medal in Atlanta that year. So despite that loss to the Australians, that was the only game they lost, actually, at the Olympics. In the fifth inning, 20-year-old Danielle Tyler came up hit a home run over the center field fence, the furthest distance on a ball field. It was the fifth inning. There were two more innings of regulation. Softball goes to seven innings. And as I said earlier, she floated around the bases. Adrenaline was pumping through her. In her excitement, she forgot to touch home base. She, you know, embraced her teammates. And when all the yelling had subsided, the Australian catcher walked down into the U.S. dugout and tagged Danielle with the new ball that the umpire had given her, because the other one went out of the park. And he or she tagged Danielle, and the umpire called Danielle out. The home run didn't count. The game remained tied 0-0. Had Danielle stepped on the plate, her team would have won 1-0, most likely, because the next two innings, no one scored any runs. The game had to go into extra innings. Australia won in extra innings, 1-0. That's tragic, right? Actually, the U.S. women's softball team had not lost an international game in 115 starts. They had a 115-game winning streak in international play. It ended that night. The pitcher on the mound for the U.S. team in the fifth inning had a perfect game going. She lost it. Danielle got distracted. Something hindered her from finishing. That's only a game, thank God. And if you YouTube Danielle Tyler, you could hear her story. It's only a game. What we're living in out there is real life. What we have to persevere through is real life. And we can't get distracted. We've got to touch home plate. It's really important. Remember all the reasons why we have to persevere. Does anyone here feel this morning that maybe you missed home plate? Like, maybe it's just been overwhelming. The enemy has pushed you down. He's been roaring in your face. He's been screaming at you. I want to lead you in two prayers this morning. They are prayers of repentance. I'm just led in my heart to lead us to pray that God will forgive us. The first one I rediscovered 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago when I preached about praying prayers from the Old Testament. It's the prayer of Nehemiah. It's chapter 1, and it's much longer than this part, but I'm just pulling out these verses, and I want us to look at it together. I'm going to read it. Why don't you just read it with me? Make it your personal prayer. Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant, Moses. Just take some time and
quietly, make that personal, and it's on your screen at home if you're watching this. Let's just make that prayer personal right now. I want us to pray another prayer, and this one is found in the Anglican Book of Common Prayer. It's kind of one of those prayers that comes from the past. It's not too far past, but it's a beautiful prayer. Let's pray this together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you through our own fault in thought and word and deed and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, forgive us all our offenses and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Quietly personalize that right now. And if you're at home, you see it on your screen. Personalize that prayer. For the sake of your Son, forgive all my offenses. Okay, that's our application for this week, to pray those two prayers. They're on our website. At home, if you're watching this, you can just click on our website, or when you go home today, just go to Church Online Past Services, and it's right at the very top of today's service. You just download a PDF, or you could look at them, take a screenshot, whatever you want. But can you pray these two prayers this week? Throw off the hindrances and throw off those things, those sins that entangle you, keep you from persevering. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Praise be to our God. Amen. Would you stand with me and look around you? If you're at home, you know, just look through your screen, see if you can see us. We'll try to see you. This is the body of Christ. These are people. This is who he died for, right? Right here. This is what it's all about, Jesus' church. God bless you today. Be filled with him and his hope. Amen.